Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents From Conquest to Colony, Empire, Wealth, and Difference in 18th-Century Brazil by Kirsten Schultz. Narrated by Alex Picard. Introduction. For both distant observers and the men who blazed the trails from Brazil's Atlantic coast into the hinterland in search of natives to enslave, the discovery of gold in the mountainous and riverine region north of Rio de Janeiro at the end of the 17th century was at once foreseen and fortuitous. "It was always well known," wrote the Italian Jesuit André João Antonil around the turn of the 18th century, "that in Brazil there were iron, gold, and silver mines, but there was always considerable inattention to discovering and exploiting them as well. Indeed, while traces of mineral deposits, including gold found in the captaincy of São Vicente in the 16th century, had conjured up visions of a new Potosí, visions pursued into the next century by itinerant and often clandestine prospectors, a significant mining enterprise eluded the Portuguese in the first centuries of conquest and settlement. Perhaps, Antonil speculated, settlers had been too comfortable living off the fruits of fertile lands and streams to invest in exploring Brazil's bowels. Or perhaps, a bent for hunting Indians in the forests distracted them from this less indecent and more useful enterprise. In any case, the dribs and drabs of alluvial ore that made their way to royal smelting houses did not inspire dissemination of the practical knowledge needed for future success in prospecting. Even men with experience in the hinterland could not tell the difference between treasure and the earth's less valuable elements. Slave raiders regularly mistook tourmalines for emeralds, and, Antonil recounted, the mulatto, who was said to have been the first discoverer of the most substantial deposits of Brazilian gold, did not know that the steel-colored pebbles that he scooped out of a stream while with some settlers to look for Indians were of the most precious metal of all. Nor did his companions to whom he showed the stones know how to recognize and esteem what he had so easily found, Antonil added. The confusion continued in the village of Daubaté as the mulatto and his companions sold the ore for a modest sum, without knowing what they sold and without the buyer knowing what he bought. Only later, when the stones ended up before the governor in Rio de Janeiro, Autour de Sá, and after they had been more carefully examined, were they recognized to be the finest gold. The gold was not only the finest, it was also copious. Other discoveries, mostly along the Espinhaço Mountains, quickly followed. Prospectors from São Paulo, northeastern Brazil, and Portugal flooded into the region. Some starved, and some struck it rich. Wealth generated from the extracted ore began to flow not only to miners, but also to smugglers, goldsmiths, slave traders, merchants, and royal coffers. If Brazil had been the monarchy's milch cow, as King João IV, reigned 1640 to 1656, had described it years earlier to the French minister in Portugal, these sizable and unexpected discoveries made American territory even more of a prize. Yet, as royal officials in Portugal and Brazil celebrated what seemed like a providential turn of events, especially when viewed alongside the decline of Portuguese commercial networks in Asia, they also recognized that the discoveries raised intricate and pressing questions. How would the Portuguese administer and exploit the new American treasure? How would the Portuguese crown defend a resurgent American empire in an Atlantic world of rivals? How would the crown govern and forge civil, political, and economic order in a distant territory and across a dynamic socioeconomic geography that encompassed indigenous peoples, Africans, and Europeans, the free and the enslaved, the wealthy and the poor? This book examines how royal officials and vassals of the Portuguese monarchy on both sides of the Atlantic understood and reckoned with these transformations and questions, and how, in the process, they redefined the status of Brazil within the empire. Portugal's sovereignty in America, as royal officials, chroniclers, and settlers affirmed, had been forged in conquests and evangelizations that incorporated new lands and peoples into the monarchy. While the political-cultural legacies of conquest endured, especially as they had been cultivated among settlers, royal officials came to argue that the discovery of gold and subsequent hinterland settlement demanded new approaches to governance and administration. Ensuring that the wealth produced in Brazil flowed into imperial networks of exchange depended not only on the allegiance of European and Europeanized settlers living far from their king, but also on a regulation of socio-economic relations defined by legal status, ancestry, labor, and wealth that differentiated Portuguese America from Portugal. Reinvigorating Portugal's imperial and commercial power, in other words, meant understanding and defending what made Brazil a colony. Conquests and colonies. While references to Brasil Colonia are recurrent in modern histories of Brazil, it was only in the 18th century, as historian Rodrigo Benz Monteiro observes in his study of the Portuguese monarchy, that royal officials began to refer primarily and consistently to the Crown's American territory as a colony. Before then, the Portuguese Crown's sovereignty comprised conquests and states, as well as commerce and navigated waterways. João V, reign 1706 to 1750, was, by the grace of God, King of Portugal and of the Algarves, of below and beyond the sea in Africa, Lord of Guinea and of the conquest, navigation, and commerce of Ethiopia, Arabia, Persia, and India, etc. Such a manifold title was but one reflection of an imperial monarchy's complex and changing constitutional dimensions and the political and administrative discontinuities that attended them. In the wake of military incursions into North Africa, the so-called papal donation, and treaties with the Catholic kings of neighboring Spain, lands claimed in eastern South America in the 16th century had become one of several ultramarine conquests, places where the Portuguese had negotiated with and warred against coastal indigenous peoples to establish enclaves of Portuguese authority. As settlement proceeded, along with references to the conquests, chroniclers and officials traded in diverse and often indefinite terms to designate the monarchy's new American territory. Writing in the 1570s within a broader debate about the religious and commercial motives for claiming lands beyond Europe, the chronicler Pedro de Magalhães Gandavo invoked the discoverer Pedro Álvares Cabral's naming ceremony in May 1500, as well as Portuguese dedication to the Order of Christ, to defend reference to the province of the Holy Cross against the more vulgar land of Brazil, so called after the dyewood extracted from the forests of indigenous coastal lands. At stake, he explained, was a diabolical effort to eradicate the memory of the sacred origins of Portugal's presence in the New World. Royal administrative schemes added to this emerging patchwork of terms used to describe the Crown's American claims within imperial nomenclature. In the 1530s, the Crown divided the coast and its hinterland into numerous hereditary parcels, which royally appointed donatary captains were expected to defend, settle, and exploit. In the wake of this arrangement's notoriously limited success, in 1548, the Crown sent Tomé de Souza as governor of all the captaincies and settlements in the lands of Brazil, intending, as Pedro Puntoni has explained, that his authority would prevail over, but not entirely annul, that of the donatory captains. The first governor, together with the royal treasurer and the magistrate who joined him, were to constitute a new administrative structure for incorporating all of Portuguese America into the monarchy. Following the restoration of Portuguese sovereignty from Spanish Habsburg rule, 1580 to 1640, in 1645, the new Braganza, King João IV, also appealed to the image of American territorial unity when he decreed that the heir to the throne would be known as Prince of Brazil. Yet even though this innovation, as Maria de Fátima Silva Gouveia observed, invoked values and notions of governability and vassalage that distinguished Brazil from other parts of the empire, it did not entail the creation of a principality in administrative terms. As the royal charter made clear, Brazil would be possessed in title only. References to American territory as a whole were also mitigated by the creation of new administrative frameworks. In 1621, territory in the north was reconfigured as the state of Maranhão, apart from remaining territories of the state of Brazil, while the various 17th-century iterations of a repartição do sul, southern district, proved more short-lived, they too reinforced the institutional pluralities through which the crown sought to exercise sovereignty. In practice, as Pedro Carjim and Susanna Munch Miranda conclude, the crown's administrative approach made Portuguese America an archipelago of settlements, a situation that favored the jurisdictional autonomy of the various poles of which it was comprised. Within this dynamic imperial lexicon, and alongside pluralistic administrative practice, official and literary references to Brazil as one of several conquests scattered across the globe suggested continuities from east to west within the Portuguese monarchy's extra-European lands. In 1736, as the Gazeta de Lisboa reported, the portfolio of a new Minister of the Navy and Conquests included nominations for Viceroys, Governors, and Captains General of the States of India, Brazil, Maranhão, the Kingdom of Angola, Islands of Madeira, Açores, Cape Verde, and Fortresses of Africa. As our conquests had come to encompass an array of political administrative categories across the monarchy, the notion of conquest itself also expanded. Already in the fledgling African enterprise, the Portuguese recognized that conquest could proceed from both war and what Afonso V, reign 1438 to 1481, described as friendly relations and arrangements. Consequently, the conquests included any lands where the Portuguese had secured a presence, not just those occupied in the wake of military victories. The conquerors, therefore, were men who had taken any of the first steps, whether bellicose or diplomatic, toward the consolidation of diverse Portuguese claims to trade and settle. In America, as Sebastioa da Rocha Pita reminded readers of his Historia da América Portuguesa, 1730, this path to securing sovereignty had been circuitous. The king Dom João III, he reported of his native Bahia, gave it to Francisco Pereira Coutinho, who was the first who came to settle after Diogo Álvares Correa, who dwelt there, and Cristóvão Jaques, who discovered it. Francisco Pereira Coutinho, who had arrived from India with great wealth and resources, and had secured royal favor, forearmed a squadron of ships, in which, accompanied by noble people for settlement and by soldiers for defense, he came to conquer the land. Discovering, dwelling, conquering. Through these intertwined rather than discrete and linear acts, the Portuguese had forged indigenous American land into the conquest of Brazil. As officials and chroniclers recognized the multifaceted actions through which a distant extra-European territory had been incorporated into the monarchy, in practice, the ideal of conquest came to frame American appeals into a shared juridical political culture, whether to overturn an inferior status relative to other territories in the monarchy acquired through inheritance or pact, to transcend geographical distance, or to seek royal grace. Conquerors, settlers, and traders could point to their service in the occupation of American land as a basis for their own authority on the ground and their status before a king with vassals across the globe. The crisis of the 17th century, especially the Dutch occupation of northeastern Brazil and the local fight to restore Portuguese sovereignty there, then afforded new opportunities to assert this status against both conquered peoples and renderings of the residents of American territory as unvaryingly an ignobly dominated by remote European power. "We are not conquered vassals," members of Salvador's town council informed the king in 1688. Their loyalty and obedience, and the resources they had expended to defend Brazil against the monarchy's rivals, commended them to recognition as vassals no different from those in the Kingdom of Portugal itself. After all, since 1653, the city of Salvador da Bahia had enjoyed the right to dispatch envoys to meetings of the representative and consultative Portuguese courtes. Yet, as officials, chroniclers, and settlers thus recognized Brazil as one of many conquests forged in war and trade, and thereby incorporated into a pluricontinental monarchy, political practice also distinguished Portuguese America from other extra-European territories. What historians have described as an incentive system of military service and rewards, conspicuous in the insignia of military orders and commanderies, privileged tours of duty in Asia and especially in Africa in wars against infidel enemies, and, conversely, excluded recognition of actions taken during the initial occupation of the Brazilian coast. Throughout the 16th century, Asia and the defense of Portuguese commercial outposts continued to draw nobility into royal service. The crown, in turn, reinforced that enterprise's prestige, creating the office of the viceroy with broad authority to act locally within the state of India in the name of the king. In Brazil, in contrast, expeditions to punish and enslave natives who resisted Portuguese settlement did not offer the same promise of distinction, and the crown did not invest in the institutionalization of royal authority and justice to the same degree. As historians have noted, a century passed between the founding of a high court, Redenção, in Goa, 1544, and its counterpart in Bahia, 1609-1652. While throughout the 17th century, the highest-ranking representative in Portuguese America remained a governor general. The Portuguese monarchy's 18th-century Atlantic turn, already evident in late 17th-century undertakings to claim territory in Rio de la Plata, and consolidated by the discovery of vast deposits of gold, renewed scrutiny of American administration and Brazil's status within the empire. The flow of gold from the Brazilian hinterland and the commerce that the new enterprise sustained suggested to royal officials that America would compensate for what had been lost in Asia to European rivals and local rulers and would serve to renovate the empire as a whole. At the same time, in the first decades of the 18th century, the initially more lucrative and glorious Asian venture remained a standard that Brazil had not yet met. Although the crown began to refer to men appointed to govern Brazil as viceroys, the new designation was associated with a previous posting of highest rank in India, rather than with a new administrative status for American territory. In Lisbon, officials also defended limits of the powers of the crown's representative in Brazil. In 1714, advising against giving the viceroy of Brazil the power to grant honorific privileges and membership in military orders, the Overseas Council, Conselho Ultramarino, explained that if the viceroy of India enjoyed his authority, it was to encourage the noble men of this kingdom to go to that state, so that in wars there they strive to achieve singular and heroic actions. The governance of India is totally military and bellicose, the counselors observed. And the viceroys are always in campaign, either at sea or on land, contending with the kings of Asia and even many times with European nations, which is not the case in Brazil. The juxtaposition of a military enterprise in Asia and its absence in America elided the history of expeditions in the previous century, deployed to end Dutch occupations in Pernambuco and Bahia, to thwart French plans for settlement in Maranhão, and to expand Portuguese sovereignty in Rio de la Plata. The council did recognize, however, that the War of Spanish Succession, 1701 to 1714, energized imperial rivalries, and more specifically foreign designs on Brazil's minds, and therefore demanded investment in the martial means of securing and defending Portuguese-American sovereignty. To begin with, Royal Counselor Antonio Rodriguez de Costa advised in 1709 the defense of Rio de Janeiro, serving as a port for the mining region, required investments even beyond the council's recent provisions for new fortification and an infantry regiment in the city. In fact, within months, his concerns materialized in clear and vivid form. In 1710, the French corsair Jean-François de Clercq launched an attack on Rio de Janeiro, but was rebuffed by local forces. No one escaped except a fugitive black who had served as a guide. One pamphlet reported of the Lusophone forces' triumph. By February 1712, however, letters reached Lisbon with news of a second, successful French assault and occupation of the city in 1711, which ended only after officials in Rio offered a ransom and return to the French prisoners of war taken the previous year. Reckoning with the French attacks, officials worried about lasting and damaging effects for both Brazil and the Kingdom of Portugal. In response, the Crown punished the actions of officials in Rio, stepped up investments in the city's fortification, and issued orders that mandated stricter supervision of foreign vessels in Brazilian ports. Defending American sovereignty, counselors warned, also required addressing broader problems of governance and allegiance. In Pernambuco in the 1710s, the Crown faced armed challenges to its authority rooted in the social order of settlement and the willingness of a local nobility to defend its status against upstart merchants. Such a development was especially alarming, Rodriguez de Costa warned, considering French ambition in America and the possibility that those vassals would embrace the protection of the King of France. In the mining region, in turn, threats to sovereignty came not only from the possibility that vassals would turn to foreign rulers, but also from a rootlessness that seemed to defy the consolidation of political order itself. The king, Rodriguez de Costa observed, could not rule over people without law, order, and obedience, without fear of magistrates and punishment, without hope of a reward. In the first decades of the 18th century, the Crown sought to address these challenges, achieve fiscal control, and thwart adventurers, interlopers, and rebels by investing in administrative personnel and by redefining the jurisdictions in which officials served. Then, and again in the 1750s, the Crown moved to formally incorporate the remaining donatary captaincies into the state of Brazil. During João V's reign, Portugal's American sovereignty was cultivated as well in symbolic and spectacular displays of royal power of unprecedented scale. Brazilian rituals of the royal life cycle grew more frequent and more lavish, especially in the mining region, where religious festivals and local rites of political obeisance became organizing elements of society. An America settled in order to extract wealth, Rodrigo Montero has posited, became the mirror that reflected, in multiple ways, the authority of the Portuguese king in Portugal and beyond. Fittingly, in Brazil, João V's funerary rites, the first to be celebrated across the empire, included especially luxuriant displays of local elites' productive and consumptive capacities, reminders of the wealth and power that had defined his rule, their American sources, and his American vassals' allegiance. Like local invocations of service to the crown, the commemorations of the king's life and death and the descriptive accounts subsequently issued inscribed Portuguese settlements in Brazil into a larger pluricontinental community of vassals defined by royal authority and tradition. These same celebrations and written accounts, however, could also make known the differences that the 18th century monarchy had come to contain. Writing on behalf of the Holy Office of the Inquisition in 1709, one censor determined that Rocha Pita's account of the Bahian funerary commemorations for Pedro II, reign 1668 to 1706, was out of date. In Lisbon, even the beginning of the reign of João V had already assuaged his subjects' grief. As a result, only recalling the distance that separated Lisbon and the City of Bahia, metropolis of Portuguese America, and the difference that distance produced made the account intelligible. Years later, writing of João V's Bahian funerary honors, one panegyrist similarly reminded readers that the king had ruled over communities and sites of production that were distinguished by geography and history, not only from each other, but, above all, from those in Europe. The king's glorious reign, the panegyrist concluded, had been a time when commerce flourished free of danger, both within the kingdom and its colonies. The reference to extra-European territories as colonies may have called to mind what the Theatine father Raphael Bluteau had summarized just a few decades earlier as a convergence of people, action, and space. A colony, Bluteau explained in his authoritative Vocabulario Portuguese e Latino, 1712 to 1728, was the people who are sent to some newly discovered or conquered land to settle it, pouvoir, added that the land so settled is also called that. This process of demographic diffusion, chroniclers and royal officials recognized, had defined Iberia itself and remained manifest in cities that had begun as Roman colonies. As the crown extended its sovereignty beyond Europe, ancient configurations had reemerged. The paths to conquest, the 16th century chronicler João de Barros reported, included sending vassals and natives to live in acquired lands, the kind of settlements the Romans called colonies. A century and a half later, one Portuguese pamphleteer observed the similarly interconnected trajectory of settlement and conflict in the more recent past. The Portuguese arrived at that coast, José Freire Monteroyo Mascanheiras wrote of eastern South America. Their colonies grew prolifically, and enlarging their conquests, they overcame the Tupinamba, the Tupineus, and the Tupuyas. Thus, across a now global empire, colonies were communities of ultramarine vassals, forged as the Portuguese had conquered, displaced, traded with, and Christianized native peoples in allegiance to the crown. By the time João V's panegyrist looked back on his reign in the colonies, however, contemporary understandings of colonies had also expanded beyond Bluteau's recapitulation of ancient legacies and acts of conquest, migration, and settlement, to include the delineation and defense of distinct social and economic functions within European empires. As Anthony Pagden has observed for Spain, Britain, and France, renewed debates about the sources of wealth and power, based on an ensemble of ideas about money, commerce, population, and the state, later denominated mercantilism, displaced an older defense of universal projects to Christianize, as well as attendant preoccupations with honor and the spirit of conquest. The administration of empire and, above all, of the imperial commercial economy became a calculation of benefits intended to privilege metropolitan interests defined as such. Among Portuguese royal officials and vassals, too, the much-debated economic dimensions of the 18th-century empire became paramount, and Brazil's colonial status was identified with limits on commerce and other productive activities imposed by metropolitan power. American resources, Brazilian-born royal counselor Alexandre de Guzmão argued plainly in 1749, were to yield European rather than American wealth. Raw materials should be extracted from colonies to be manufactured in the capital, the polymath Antonio Ribeiro Sanchez explained in a mid-18th century treatise on Portuguese America. And all the foodstuffs that do not grow in the capital should be planted in the colonies, he further clarified, as well as those that grow in the primary state with difficulty or those that are bought abroad. As a colony, in other words, Portuguese America encompassed socio-economic communities intended to complement and support, rather than reproduce metropolitan ways of producing and consuming wealth. Consequently, governance and administration entailed defining how Brazil's various enterprises, plantations, mines, and markets, were both fundamentally different from the European polity and society that forged them, and integrated into networks of exchange defined by European authority and prosperity. Such an understanding of the relationship between Portugal and its American territory could undercut appeals to political and religious incorporation manifest in royal and ecclesiastical festivals and in local elites' invocations of vassalage and service to the crown in conquest. When, in 1746, Portuguese merchants in Rio de Janeiro complained to the king that the descendants of the first settlers had excluded them from the city's public offices, they made their case by pointing to local claims to authority that, they insisted, mistook Brazil for something that it was not. As a consequence, the merchants protested they were reduced to a system in which America was a conquest and not a colony. Defending their demand for access to elected offices, they disparaged a local settler elite whose power depended on summoning from the countryside men so poor that in order to buy the clothing required for an appearance in the city, they had sold the only young black who works to cultivate what sustains their families. In contrast, the petitioners had the means and the knowledge of the economy with which the people should be administered. The colony of Brazil, the petitioners thus suggested, was a project that followed from, but also ran counter to, legacies of conquest, particularly the granting of exclusive privileges to conquerors and settlers. In the decades that followed, even as American vassals continued to appeal to a transatlantic economy of royal grace and honors, they increasingly recognized this new politics of colonies and the socioeconomic hierarchies that it encompassed. By the 1790s, and as signs of Brazil's own economic capacities mounted, even those who defended the value of a commerce that produced rich vassals in both Europe and America, including the Brazilian-born Bishop Azevedo Coutinho, invoked difference, dependency, sacrifice, exclusion, and metaphors of childhood to explain the status of the colonies of Portugal. The old colonial system, one of Rio de Janeiro's chroniclers argued in the wake of the early 19th century Napoleonic invasion of Iberia, had come to be not the complementary outcome, but rather the antithesis of the monarchy's incorporative potential in America. The shift in political and economic nomenclature and practice surveyed here was not clear-cut. From the 16th through the 18th century, the Portuguese crown sought to organize the extraction of wealth and to protect and enhance trade to benefit merchants and to fill royal coffers, even as chroniclers celebrated violent conquests that extended the crown's sovereignty and ushered in the Christian mission and civilization. And within official discourse, Portugal and its conquests stood in for the empire until the early 19th century. Still, increasing references to Brazil as Portugal's colony or to Portugal's American colonies, together with changing notions of what those terms signified, expressed throughout the 18th century in correspondence and official communication, political treatises and law, and published pamphlets and chronicles, raised questions about how people living on both sides of the Atlantic understood the project and legitimacy of empire, and the scope and nature of American society and economy, as well as the threats, old and new, to prosperity and power. As this book argues, even as some answers to these questions point to the crown's failure to fully incorporate American vassals into the imperial monarchy, by the mid-18th century, royal policy had come to assume that what would guarantee the monarchy's and the Kingdom of Portugal's prosperity was not simply the discovery of resources and the claiming of new lands, but also the forging of a particular kind of social order in Portuguese America, one that ensured that resources would be extracted and exchanged within an imperial economy. While this process, debated and contested on both sides of the Atlantic, entailed reproducing metropolitan institutions and cultivating expectations of justice and political allegiance in America, it also meant defining what made society and the economy in Brazil different from those of Portugal, and defending why those differences needed to be upheld. The system and the old regime. Brazil's colonial status and its impact on Portuguese American and imperial economies and polities have been extensively studied and debated by historians, In the last quarter of the 20th century, the old colonial system, most fully elaborated by Brazilian historian Fernando Novais, served as a guiding framework for much historical research on Brazil under Portuguese rule and the crises that led to Brazil's independence. Building on and refining Caio Prado Jr.'s 1907 to 1990 sweeping analysis of the structures of the Brazilian and imperial economies and the socio-economic interests and relations produced within these structures, namely large-scale agricultural and enslaved labor, Novais's Portugal e Brasil na crise do antigo sistema colonial, 1777 to 1808, 1979, examined the monopolistic administrative policies that sustained production based on slavery and privileged the interest of metropole over colony. The late 18th century reforms intended to diversify and further integrate the imperial economy. And finally, the protracted crisis that ultimately dismantled the system. Although in the last quarter of the 18th century, Portuguese merchants reaped rewards from Brazilian commodities resold in Europe as prices rose due to interruptions in Caribbean production, the old colonial system, Novais argued, could not be reconciled with economic transformations in the Atlantic world brought about by the Industrial Revolution, a commercial and financial infrastructure in Portugal that could not accommodate Brazilian exports, and Portuguese merchants' inability to supply Brazilian markets with the volume of goods in demand. Among the most salient symptoms of the system's breakdown was the growth of contraband trade in Brazil's ports. Brazil's political independence in 1822 brought the crisis to an end with a rejection of the old colonial system's monopolies, already dismantled with the opening of Brazil's ports in 1808, that left intact large-scale export agriculture based on enslaved labor as the basis for Brazil's continued integration into Atlantic and global capitalist economies. Historians followed Novais's analysis with both quantitative investigations of the commercial economy and qualitative examinations of the socio-cultural mediations through which various sectors of Brazilian society experienced the old colonial system. As Novais himself argued in the opening chapter of Historia da Vida Privada no Brasil, 1997, provisory and precarious aspects of quotidian and private experience in Brazil under Portuguese rule reflected social relations defined by the convergence of aristocratic aspirations and mercantile practices, manifest, above all, in the slave market, where the capacity to purchase human beings made settlers, senhores, lords. In the 1990s, however, economic historians, most notably Valentim Alexandre, Jorge Pedreira, and João Fragoso, challenged Novais's account of the colonial system and its scope. As Pedreira argued, even as the Portuguese continued to pursue mercantilist policies, the old colonial system was pervious. Portuguese imperial commerce was based on northern, central, and southern European shipping and finance, and included direct trade in certain commodities between northern Europe and Brazil, as well as intercolonial exchange between Africa and the Indian Ocean network, and above all, in the transatlantic slave trade conducted by traders in Africa and Brazil. In Brazil, as Fragoso's research showed, trade with Portugal and the slave trade between Brazil and Africa also fueled the development of local and regional economies, commodity production, and a wealthy landed and mercantile elite. Rendering the empire's 18th century structure as poles, metropole and colony, bound together by metropolitan commercial exclusivity, therefore, cannot account for the complexity of intra- and trans-imperial exchange, a point elaborated too in Luiz Felipe Alencastro's history of the commercial, social, and political connections between the slaving ports of Eastern South America and Angola. As economic historians thus revised understandings of the old colonial system by illuminating its less than systematic effects, social and cultural historians began to argue that the conceptual framework itself obscured as much as it revealed the complexities of Portuguese imperial ideology and practice. As Júnia Ferreira Furtado observes in her study of merchants and commercial culture in Brazil's mining region, to the extent that metropole and colony are purely formal concepts, constructed with reference to opposition and exclusion, they do not necessarily account for the integration of interests, the sharing of cultural values, affirmations of allegiance and dissidence, and the production of alterity that concurrently defined the relationship between early modern Portugal and Brazil. A collection of essays on the old regime in the tropics, edited by Fragoso, Maria de Fatima Gouveia, and Maria Fernando Bicayo, has posed a similar challenge to the explanatory potential of the old colonial system. Calling for a new and broad research agenda that would undo an interpretation founded on the irreducible economic duality of metropole and colony, Fragoso, Gouveia, and Bicayo argue for a reframing of the experiences and effects of wealth and its accumulation that recognizes how social hierarchies and a logic of power in the old regime were recreated in Portuguese America. The shift from viewing the work of empire primarily through economic relation toward examining Portuguese American society and political culture has entailed a shift as well in understanding how political authority was conceived in the early modern era and, more specifically, recognizing, as Portuguese historian Antonio Manuel España maintained, that the practice of power was decentralized. The essays in O Antigo Regime nos Trópicos, 2001, and much subsequent research take this decentralized and incorporative logic as a point of departure for examining how Portuguese authority was constituted in Brazil at the local level. Building on the work of C.R. Boxer, historians have studied the political culture of town councils, where many of the men who enriched themselves with profits from exports, eternal markets, and the slave trade found a venue for the political expression of their interests and enunciation of their status. Such arrangements did not contest the monarchy's American sovereignty, but rather affirmed ties among these men, local representative institutions, and the crown. As Portuguese who went to America took with them expectations of hierarchical social order that materialized in the enslavement of Africans and in conflict with and subjugation of indigenous peoples, the crown rewarded their conquests and wars waged in the name of the king. In turn, appointments to offices, honors, and access to resources, settlers and their descendants argued, made them a nobility of the land. As Fragoso and Gouveia explain in introducing a subsequent collection of essays, the logic of the empire stems, then, from the process of fusing conceptions of the corporative and of political pact based in the monarchy and guaranteeing as principle the autonomy of local power. These old regime incorporations also meant that in Brazil, settlement was defined by what España described as a social architecture of settlers, colonos, of European origin, while other political cultures remained as subaltern elements almost without expression except on the fringes of the colonial world or in moments of grave crisis for the dominant government. The European old regime logic of power, embodied in law and institutions, was able to assimilate an unprecedentedly large-scale slave system into the existing social order. The slave, or even a multitude of slaves, España argued, did not constitute a dissonant element of the community that required a reconfiguration of its design, its theory, or its law. Rather, like other forms of dependency, slavery remained a matter of domestic governance. Nor should slavery be seen as the mere means of mercantile capital, Fragoso and Gouveia elaborate. Within the old regime, they contend, relations of reciprocity took shape between slaves, people of color, and owners, many times in the form of kinship and especially godparentage, and within social hierarchies capable of naturalizing socioeconomic differences, thus constituting the social fabric. Recognizing the nature and intricacy of these relations, according to España, also exposes the limits of an understanding of colonial history as a totality defined by monotonous submission and of a nomenclature of social order that privileges dichotomy over complexity. If the colonizers were from the kingdom and the colonized were the settlers, colonos, of European origin and mixed, mestizo, offspring, España inquired, where do we situate the natives? Introducing a recent collection of essays on the governance of others in the Portuguese Empire, Angela Xavier and Cristina Nogueira da Silva similarly observe that the incorporative potential of early modern political culture in Portugal calls into question the concept of colonial Brazil as it has been formulated within an imperial imaginary of Marxist origins and the attendant impasse within the vocabulary of extra-European social order. Like España's, their description of American society under Portuguese rule begins with colonizing reinos, born in the Kingdom of Portugal, but then follows with colonos, the population of Portuguese origin, and the colonizados, colonized, the indigenous. While España identified the socio-political expressions of enslaved Africans outside the political spaces of settler society, hidden in forests, in a quilombo, in slave quarters, or in a yard, Xavier and Nogueira da Silva, in contrast, call attention to the broader ramifications of the specificity created as many Portuguese settlements displaced and marginalized indigenous peoples and became wholly dependent on enslaved African labor, producing what later historiography configured as a society of settlers, colonos, and slaves, rather than a society of colonizers and colonized. Both schemes, however, place Africans and their American-born descendants, majorities in some settlements, on the periphery of Brazil's socio-political order. To the extent that Africans were incorporated into societies as dependents, they were also differentiated from other dependent settlers by law, as well as by European claims about African cultures, religions, and physical appearances. The question of how to reckon with both social relations that allied an ancient dichotomy of colonizer and colonized expressed in geography, and the manifold ways in which the institution of slavery forged and maintained Portuguese sovereignty in America, is also at the core of the critique of the old regime in the tropics as a framework for defining Brazil's status within the empire. Efforts to overturn the historiography of the old colonial system, Laura de Melo Souza has argued, overlook its contribution to understanding complex political intellectual transformations, even as the old regime in the tropics and its emphasis on incorporation privileges a European gaze and effaces the extent to which slavery shaped the foundations of social and economic relations in ways that diverged from those in Europe. The specificity of Portuguese America, Melo Souza pointedly concludes, did not reside in the pure and simple assimilation of an old regime world, but rather in its perverse recreation. Large-scale export agriculture based on enslaved labor and commercial monopoly emerged not as extensions of an established political and economic order, but rather as the structures of a new system that defined the relationship between Portugal and Brazil and shaped royal administration of the territory. The extermination of indigenous peoples, as well as slavery as a regime of domination, Pedro Puntoni similarly argues, together with the constant presence of mercantile interest, produced a social environment that was unstable and at odds with the rules of the peninsular old regime. In other words, although in Europe the conditions of freedom and slavery had been reckoned with as a medieval law, society and politics yielded to an early modern old regime. When the Portuguese forged an Atlantic empire, European hierarchies in incorporative categories could not entirely accommodate the increasing scale and racialization of enslavement and the new social and cultural geographies of violence and dispossession that sustained both the seaborne and territorial dimensions of that empire. As a result, out of the range of interactions among Europeans, Africans, and indigenous peoples, a new American economic and social order emerged. Debates about the scope of the colonial system and the old regime also turn around divergent assumptions about the relationship between law and the institutions it upheld, and political and economic relations within early Brazilian societies. The old regime was a logic of representation and social organization that was fundamentally open to modification, España asserted. And this, in turn, allowed for its extension beyond Europe without dramatic permutation. For the colonizers, he explained, metropole and colonies formed a quasi-continuum of political traditions, representations, and forms of communication and exchange. As España also emphasized, such a description pertains to the society of colonos, settlers with diverse forms of connection to Portugal. Critics, in turn, call into question whether the normative aspects of law and institutions can be taken as stand-ins for historically contingent practices, and whether, in the context of extermination and large-scale enslavements of natives and Africans, it makes sense to delineate settler societies to such an extent and apart from a broader range of local social relations. Settler campaigns against indigenous peoples and African expressions of authority, including free communities, quiombos, suggest that what España called other norms did not remain outside the field of vision or outside the political spaces of settler society. With regard to the ideal of old regime incorporation, although law and custom recognized enslaved natives and Africans as dependents, the fictions of paternal authority rarely did more than thinly veil a more abject reality defined and contained by coercion and violence. Manumission, flight, and other forms of resistance, together with enslavers' responses to these actions, also presented at least momentary alterations in the practice of the European patriarchal household, or big house, recreated in Brazil. Nor could the incorporative potential of the old regime remain isolated from imperial expansion's other aims. As Herman Bennett explains, writing on royal and religious authority in 17th-century New Spain, the crown and the church at once recognized the domestic authority of slave owners and infringed on that authority, as they asserted control over how Africans could experience themselves in American societies. At the same time, the incorporation of enslaved people as domestic dependents, as vassals, and as Christians was aimed to transform and control African bodies and souls, to discipline rather than ameliorate, and, above all, to distance Africans from African societies and the selves and persons they and their ancestors were before they were enslaved. As the debates described here indicate, recent histories of early Brazil have regarded the old colonial system and the old regime in the tropics as alternative interpretations of the history of Portuguese authority in and beyond Europe. These same debates, however, also point to the ways that, as explanatory frameworks, the old regime in the tropics and the old colonial system illuminate intertwined expressions of authority and the tensions between incorporation and difference that constituted early modern empires. In the conquest of Brazil, settlement served kings who depended on various extra-European sources of wealth and glory. At the same time, settlement also quickly came to rely upon the coercive displacement of people cast off from Portugal in empire-wide convict labor schemes, and, above all, people removed from American and African lands in intra-American and transatlantic slave trades to be legally, socially, and culturally marked for exploitation in European settlement. The exercise of sovereignty required, therefore, what Xavier and Nogueira da Silva describe as the management of diversity and difference, an endeavor that, across several centuries, drew upon dynamic and always contested notions of legitimacy and political social order, as well as changing technologies to be deployed in achieving its aims. From Conquest to Colony examines ideas about governance, incorporation, social difference, and wealth as they took shape in Portugal and Brazil following the discovery of gold and the European settlement of Brazil's hinterland, and the policies and political practices that these ideas inspired. Many of those who reflected on the status of Brazil in the empire and the exercise of authority in America did so within interconnected circles of intellectual activity and officialdom. As we will see, in Salvador de Bahia, the seat of political authority in early 18th century Brazil, American and European-born officials joined together to deliberate on recent transformations, while in Lisbon, a new academy of history entrusted with writing on Portugal and the conquests included among its members men who served the crown in the kingdom, the empire, and other parts of Europe, where they forged socially and scholarly connections with local counterparts. While an older historiography described these men as estrangeiros, to indicate that their intellectual formation was distinct from and at odds with that of the traditional educational establishment in Portugal, the writings and exchanges examined here affirm more recent scholarship about the broader resonance of cosmopolitan networks connecting Portugal and its empire and other parts of Europe. Consequently, debates about the 18th century empire within the royal court, informal academic venues, print culture, and local political life in Portugal, Asia, and America drew on diverse, and in some cases innovative, claims about authority, wealth, trade, labor, and colonies. These debates also reflected upon earlier endeavors to regulate the kingdom's and the empire's economies and identified needs for recalibrations. Informed by contemporary deliberations about wealth and commerce, as well as by what Alexandre de Guzmão called reason and experience, Portuguese officials sought to reckon with new flows of gold, especially their ramifications for imperial trade and international relations. At the center of debates were Great Britain, its alliance with Portugal during the War of Spanish Succession, and the Methuen Treaty, 1703, that ended barriers to importing English manufacturers and, in turn, opened English ports to Portuguese wines. Even as the treaty affirmed a break with earlier protectionist policy, in the following decades, Guzmão and other officials remained committed to regulating the flow of goods and money within and beyond the empire's economy. As we will see, Guzmão also argued that implementing new and more systematic forms of taxation and exchange at the local level in Brazil would ensure metropolitan prosperity. While extracting wealth from American territory had animated Portuguese settlement since Cabral's landing in 1500, Guzmão envisioned a more extensive exercise of royal authority over the American economy that would set aside local arrangements when necessary and promote forms of economic, social, and moral production and exchange that reflected Brazil's status among what he called colonies of the ultramar. 18th century claims about the regulation of imperial space in American society, the mercantile and fiscal projects they inspired, and the responses they elicited on the ground in Portugal and Brazil were shaped as well by local histories and socio-political conditions. Compared with other European states, the decentralized old regime exercise of political authority and representation in Iberia was, as Regina Graffa has argued, often at odds with the unifying aspects of mercantile policy. Consequently, attempts at reform and new regulation were met with local affirmations of the right to contest innovation that did not respect traditional, contractual forms of local representation. In Brazil's mining region in the mid-18th century, residents renewed challenges to royal policy, denouncing Guzmão's administrative and tax reforms as an attack on old regime justice. Consequently, and as in previous decades, implementation was negotiated. Nor did numerous iterations of trading monopoly and monetary and commercial regulations, old and new, inhibit the growth of American elites' wealth, which, in some places, assumed spectacular forms. Still, over the course of the 18th century, in official and local discourse and practice, visions of Brazil as a colony, a territory with distinct societies that sustained a subordinate function to produce wealth that would circulate beyond its borders, reshaped older imperial projects of expansion and incorporation through conquest and conversion. In this sense, the old regime in the tropics and the old colonial system represent a chronology of empire in which imperial aspirations and practices preceded colonial situations. In the 17th and 18th centuries, the crown and the nobility depended on extra-European sources of wealth. As Fragoso and Sampaio explain, even more so than their counterparts in other European monarchies, Portuguese elites obtained their centrality and wherewithal in the periphery. In the 18th century, understandings of this predicament were refracted through contemporary claims about wealth and power. On the one hand, within the political culture of the monarchy, as Melo Assoso observes, gift, grace, or favor tended to be displaced by more pragmatic values, while the scope of royal authority increased at the expense of conciliar and representative norms. On the other hand, royal counselors expressed concern about a balance of trade that also shaped the balance of power among Europe's empires. To meet the challenge of the American mines and commercial potential, they argued, required not only exercising good government and appealing to the ideal of a continuum of law and tradition, but also reckoning with the manifold and contested consequences of difference within American and European societies, and managing, accordingly, production, consumption, and the flow of people and goods within the empire and beyond. Authority, wealth, and difference. From Conquest to Colony draws on the research and insights generated by both the old regime in the tropics and the old colonial system frameworks, and the debates among their practitioners. At the same time, the analysis presented here shifts the focus from the structural and institutional dimensions of conquest and colony toward changing understandings of extra.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.